Two recent industrial spills on Indiana's Lake Michigan shore have made headlines. But in Burns Harbor, the port has been working to change the image of lakefront industry by adopting new green measures. This work was supported in part by the Solutions Journalism Network, and Great Lakes Now contributor Carrie Leiderson brings us the story.
These trucks are waiting to load or unload steel at the ports of Indiana Burns Harbor, and as they sit, their engines idle. Located at the southern end of Lake Michigan, Burns Harbor is one of the busiest ports on the Great Lakes, and that means lots of traffic, around 350,000 trucks a year. Ryan McCoy is the port's director.
So every morning we have a morning rush where trucks are coming in early. You know, a lot of these guys want to try to get first in line to get loaded. So this is where NLMK receives their raw material.
NLMK is a Russian-owned steel manufacturer. It's one of about 30 tenants at the port and the largest employer on site.
So we have incoming loads of scrap that are going on to their sorting operation. And we're also seeing inbound trucks that are going to be taking out their finished products, so coils and slabs.
So they can't turn their engines off, so they're emitting that whole time that they're moving around.
They're constantly have to move up in line.
The 600-acre port sits on Indiana's 45-mile Lake Michigan shoreline, and it's surrounded by beachfront communities and Indiana Dunes National Park, a natural wonder and an important part of the region's tourism. But the port is also home to heavy industry. Most tenants are connected to steel production.
Steel is a vital part to our nation. I mean, it is the backbone of our nation. Unfortunately, historically, Northwest Indiana's industry has had some incidents that have led to negative connotations on industry.
A series of spills that garnered major news coverage have left many suspicious about area industrial operators.
And now take a look. This is what closed Indiana Dunes National Park beaches look like today.
In September of 2021, a plume of orange iron-tainted wastewater from a U.S. steel plant adjacent to the port spilled into Lake Michigan. Only 12 days later, another spill from the same U.S. steel facility, this time an oily discharge. Both spills prompted Indiana Dunes National Park and the nearby community of Ogden Dunes to shut down access to Lake Michigan.
So unfortunately, that was just the tip of the iceberg.
Victoria Wittig is the senior program specialist with Save the Dunes, a nonprofit that works to preserve the Indiana Dunes.
2017, there was a hexavalent chromium spill at the U.S. Steel facility right on the shores of Lake Michigan. Hexavalent chromium was made famous in the movie Aaron Brockovich. It's a carcinogen. We really need these facilities to step up to the plate and start to protect the waters that they need for their operations, but that we need for our drinking water and for our ecosystems to be sustained and be healthy.
As port director, Ryan McCoy is well aware of how industrial pollution reflects on the port. But the port is taking steps in an effort to improve.
Being a part of the industrial corridor of Indiana here, we want to make sure that we have a positive impact and not a negative impact on the community. That's something that we're very focused on with programs like Green Marine, is changing that reputation and showing that these different industries that reside here in the ports and that are our neighbors also can have a positive impact and improve our national lakeshore.
In 2014, the port joined Green Marine, a multinational organization started in 2007.
Green Marine is a voluntary environmental certification program for the shipping industry.
David Bolduc is Green Marine's executive director.
Any port or ship owner or terminal operator who decides to be certified commits to improve its environmental performance beyond regulatory compliance.
Green Marine scores its members in a variety of categories on a 5-point scale. A 1 indicates compliance with government regulations. Higher scores are earned with additional investments or actions. In 2020, the port scored a 4 in spill prevention, a 4 in community impacts, a 3 in environmental leadership, a 2 in greenhouse gas and air pollutants, and a 2 in waste management. Independent verifier Randy Helland has tracked the port's progress since they joined Green Marine in 2014.
I would love to see them just continuing to improve. If they continue to improve and go up the ladder, one day maybe making a maximum score of 5s in each category, and if someone does that, they're knocking it out of the park. Being a verifier within Green Marine, one of the privileges I have is to not only come alongside ports and terminals and shipping companies and verify where they're at within the standards of Green Marine, but to talk about where they want to go and what they want to accomplish over time and to help them develop a plan to get there.
One issue Burns Harbor plans to address is greenhouse gas emissions from all those idling trucks. Behind the port's administration building, Ryan McCoy shows us where one of the port's planned Green Marine projects will go.
So this is going to be our truck marshaling yard. It's 6 acres from end to end. So right now we have our trucks that come in over the bridge behind us here. They all will do the clover leaf. All 350,000 a year will be able to come around the clover leaf and potentially come in and park and shut their vehicles down, shut their trucks down in the truck marshaling yard.
So then they don't have to be lining up inside the port, running their engines,
correct,
all that diesel exhaust.
Like we saw on the tour earlier, we won't have to have them lining up on the roads, leaving their trucks running, just inching forward one truck length at a time.
When the marshaling yard is ready in 2023, it's expected to reduce annual carbon emissions by the equivalent of a single truck idling continuously for over 13 years.
So it's more efficient for the customer and you're getting rid of that pollution while the trucks are running?
Yes, much more efficient for the customers. Cuts down the amount of carbon dioxide going into the air, the amount of diesel emissions.
Across from the truck marshaling yard, another green project is underway.
Much of our stormwater goes directly into Lake Michigan, so we have to have those processes and procedures in place to protect the lake.
Nick Harper is the port's operations manager.
So these are some of the jack pines that we planted as part of the USDA GLRI grant we received with them. The jack pines are native to the state of Indiana, and these are going to be great at catching some of the fugitive dust that blows around in the area. These also suck up a ton of stormwater, so it helps us lessen the stormwater runoff we have onto the roads and other impervious areas.
When you look at the whole port, 600 acres, you know, a lot of hard surfaces, a lot of heavy industry going on. Does it feel sometimes overwhelming or like, you know, this is just a drop in the bucket compared to the environmental impact that you are having?
It is an overwhelming task. It's not something that we can do on our own. We are one of many industries in the area that have done these GLRI plantings to get some green back in the area. We want to get that national lakeshore landscape back and do whatever we can to get the green canopy back around us.
Two Burns Harbor tenants have also joined Green Marine, the shipping company FedNav and Metro Ports.
Metro Ports is our breakbulk stevedore. They are the ones that handle all the bulk cargo that come in here.
Bulk cargo, like this furnace coke, can be pretty dusty, but Metro Ports has taken steps to address that issue.
So next to us over here is a water cannon they had customized especially for their operations. Every time the loaders put their buckets into the pile of cargo, there's generally some dust produced, as well as when they dump into the hoppers, as they're seeing right now. But because the water cannon is on, it's catching the dust in the air before it gets into the lake and causes dust air conditions around the port.
So right now, any dust from that furnace coke that's being moved, this will help keep the dust down?
Correct, yep.
Community engagement is a category where the port scored high, 4 out of 5 points.
We have 6 annual commission meetings where we discuss new projects going on within the port. They are public. So it's a way for the public to come in and sort of interact with us on what their opinions are on any of our new projects going on.
But environmental leaders in the community that we spoke to were not aware of the public forums.
Would you like to hear more specifically about what they're doing to reduce emissions or increase sustainability? Do you want them to reach out to the community more directly?
Yes, we are open to all of those communications, those conversations, those partnerships that are built so they understand more of what it is we're looking to see from them, and they can share with us what it is they're trying to achieve.
Today, two international vessels known as salties dock and unload steel coils originating from Turkey.
Bringing cargoes and freight in by water is much cleaner than bringing cargo in by truck. Average vessel can take 10 to 15,000 tons of cargo, whereas if it was trucked in or railed in, you're looking at 20 to 100 tons per move. So definitely cleaner, more sustainable cargo movement by vessel. With our proximity to the lake and the river system, it definitely adds benefit to us.
I think the sustainability is not optional anymore. I think the consumer has a demand that they're only going to do business and purchase from companies that have sustainability programs. And I think our goals have to get bolder. I think we have to have loftier goals. And I think that zero emissions are possible. I think there is a lot of technology out there that supports zero emissions and full sustainability.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.